Hello everybody, good morning, or good evening, or good afternoon, and this is the beauty of these events, because as you know, this event is an international one. The ambition is to speak to people interested in NFT wherever they are in the world, and it's beautiful since the home page of the events, where there is many different timing for the start, because it depends where you are and not really what is the time of the events. So this is really the aspect of this expo, what to be international, and here we are. Probably you already catch my Italian accent. I hope that it will be not so strong and that you can understand me. Any case, but I repeat, this is the beauty of these events, people from everywhere in the world. But this can be also the problem. In fact, at the moment, two of the speaker of this panel are still in connection, are not connected yet. So I start introducing you myself and the first speaker, and then we will start to discuss and we will wait for the other speaker to join. But we didn't want to let everybody wait for us, so we prefer to start only two of us. I am Federico Morgantini. I am a mechanical engineer and I have a professional short master in MIT in digital transformation. I grew up in Italy, then I lived 15 years in Asia, in Shanghai and Hong Kong. And now I'm back in Italy, where I am an entrepreneur. I invested in many startups in blockchain and crypto business, and I am a journalist. I write about technology and about blockchain for Forbes, the Italian version of Forbes. And I have also a TV show, the name is Blockchain & Co. It's a TV show on Sky, the Italian Sky TV. I don't want to be boring, so I prefer to stop speaking about me and I introduce you Alex Capezza, an Italian very famous in gaming and in NFT world. Alex, please introduce yourself. Tell us about your history and what brings you in the amazing world of NFT.
Hey everybody, thank you very much, Federico, for the introduction. I'm Alex. In the past couple of years, I've been working in the gaming world, and then a couple of years ago, then I discovered the blockchain, the crypto industry. And as you all know, NFT is changing the world. NFT is on the mouth of everybody. Everybody is now eyeing NFT. So my role now is trying to build huge communities, global communities, both in the blockchain and the video game industry. And I believe that everybody, even people that are not playing video games today, in the next couple of years are going to actually own at least one NFT. What do you think, Federico? What is your take on this, on NFT?
You know, having this TV show since almost 2 years, I really got the opportunity to interview many, many startups, and I discovered little by little that the NFT world is, how to say, very big, because now it's famous, the NFT as a digital art. But if you think already since 2-3 years ago, there is application as NFT in video gaming, in tracking of luxury stuff, in logistic service, in financial service, and so many applications. So now why probably the NFT got so famous? Because we speak about art, and art is really something that is well understood from everybody. No matter the age, no matter the location of your life, no matter the study you did, you can be an engineer or you can be a poet, and you know, you understand the value of art. So I think the art was the way to bring mainstream the NFT, but in reality, the application are so many, and especially in these events in Nemesis, is right to speak also about the application that are not in digital art. This is one of the reasons why the organization invite you in this test panel, because you are an expert in video games and in digital world, so you can bring an experience that not so many people have. So, as you know, we hope the other two speakers to join. My ambition was to manage your experience. I am here to manage the experience of the other speaker, but I'm happy to discuss as well. But in any case, I ask you to make an excursus of the NFT in gaming. You know gaming since the beginning, probably you know gaming since
yes.
Commodore 64 40 years ago. So tell us when the NFT entered in the video games, what are the main applications in video games, and in special, what can be the future of gaming thanks to NFT?
Yeah, it's a very interesting conversation to have this one, because basically if you think about gaming now, we are in a moment where gaming, there's a traditional gaming, and then there is the future of gaming, which is the blockchain gaming. It's really a funny thing to say, traditional gaming, right? People now in traditional gaming are buying assets. Let's say Fortnite, for instance. Fortnite is the game that everybody, even people that don't play video games, know, right? So when people buy a skin, like some objects inside Fortnite, they don't actually own that skin or the object. This object is owned by Epic Games, which is the producer of Fortnite. And this can be applied to all of the possible games. For instance, FIFA. FIFA from EA Sports. All of my friends play FIFA. All of my nephew play FIFA, right? But when you buy a player in FIFA, you're not actually buying a player in the game. You're buying just the idea of buying that player. With blockchain gaming, with the NFT, that paradigm changes forever, because you are not just buying something from EA Sports, and they're still owning that. You're actually buying something. And for instance, when you buy something in the blockchain game, you can buy a land. I've been helping another metaverse called The Sandbox as a consultant. And the idea there is that you can buy a piece of land and you can own it, and then you can sub-rent it to someone else, and you actually create an income. And then, of course, you can also create objects. And for instance, you can create skins, you can create weapons, you can create any kind of avatar. And you can use that for yourself, but you can also sell it to someone else. And that's the biggest change. That's the biggest application. Usually, there is an industry, which is the gambling industry, which is the one where people in marketing especially tried the newest thing. But actually, now gaming is taking that away from gambling, in my opinion, and is applying this to NFT. So I guess, Federico, the first thing that everybody is listening to us now needs to understand is that NFTs and blockchain in gaming is an opportunity not just to play, but actually to play to earn. And this can really create a job for millions of people out there that are listening to us now. Gaming in the past couple of years became something like is a real job. Like, just think about esports, for instance. People now are playing competitive video games in their home. They're just buying a good laptop, probably an MSI with a good, you know, a powerful laptop. They just buy headsets. They buy keyboards, mouse, and then they just need to train themselves. This is not sport, of course, because it's different, but it's still a sort of competition when people are going to compete against any other person in the world. And that was the first part of creating a job in the video game industry. Now with blockchain, you take this to the next level. And also with the Nemesis, as you can see, you're going to explore a metaverse, you're going to meet people, so you can create a real but virtual economy. I guess that's the biggest change, Federico.
Sì, but the big change is in the technology. As we know, in the moment in which there is a third party that manage the skin, the weapons, the object, the skill in a video game, somehow you are linked to this owner of the video game or of the digital worlds. The moment in which, thanks to the blockchain, you can really own a digital object, change everything. Because in the moment in which it's yours and you decide to sell or you decide to give to a friend of you for some reason, you really are free to do it. You can transfer it in the properties of the other person. No? Probably many people that are following this panel are expert in the meaning of blockchain and NFT, but I think it's right to give a short explanation for those that are not so expert. In the moment in which you have a digital object, for example, the most easy to understand for everybody is the PDF. You have a PDF file. You decide to give this PDF file to someone else. You send by email. Doing the email, you make a copy of this file. The file arrive to destination, but remain also in your computer, your phone. So you go to make a copy of the digital object, and you send a copy of this digital object. So after that you send, you still keep the object and also the destination person keep the object. With the NFT, it's not like this. In the moment in which you decided to transfer, for example, a weapon or, for example, a card inside the games to someone else, you give to him and you don't have the code. And this is very, very important because this is a way to transfer value in a digital way. It's the first time on the blockchain app for this. Yes. And you can do it without the third part. So it's not that the third part can, just to push you to buy again, can cancel your skill or cancel your card. So this brings games, bring the virtual worlds to a non-centralized level. So it means that once you start the contest, players are really the subject, the player of the contest. So you saw you was an expert of game in the old way, and you are an expert of games in the new way. What can be the difference for player, for company, maybe also for startup that nowadays maybe they can make a service inside the virtual worlds, being independent from who build the virtual worlds. So this is very interesting.
Absolutely.
That's what is for thing. You the main opportunities that this new technology bring?
Yeah, I think the main opportunity to me is an opportunity to work and to create a work for yourself. It's actually funny that last year something happened around March. Maybe people listening remember that we were stuck home, right? For me, that of course changed a lot in my life, but it didn't change a lot in the sense that I was already working remotely. I was working since 2013 from home. And many people just realized that they can work from home. They don't need to work in an office. So many people now are studying different things. Some people went to Netflix and just watched Netflix, right? They just been watching. Other people studied and other people find opportunities. And people that discover blockchain find the hugest opportunity of their life, because being in blockchain today is like understanding what Amazon was before Amazon became a real thing. So the first thing that I would tell to everybody is study. Study at university, study on YouTube. You choose your media. But at the end of the day, the important thing is to study, to find what you want to do. Blockchain, in the end, is a vertical. It's an industry. Then inside blockchain, there is music, there is video games, there is There is everything. There's like any kind of industry is going to be influenced by blockchain. Let's imagine, for instance, I'm going to go to a concert or going to buy to a football match, right? I'm going to need to buy a ticket. But then for some reason, I cannot go to the concert, to the football match anymore. So I need to sell it. In the past, you will sell it on a secondary market ticket. But then the person who buys the ticket doesn't know if the ticket is still valid, if it was already used. With the blockchain, this is over. I sell my ticket on a blockchain. I send it to someone else. And the blockchain says, authentically, this is the ticket from this company for this event. And the seller is happy, the buyer is happy, because they both know that they did something good for each other. The seller gets paid, and the buyer can use the concert for a ticket. And this is just one application. About music, King of Leon, a huge known group, just released a couple of months, probably 2 months ago, an album in NFT. So if you think about the history of music, we went from radio to CD-ROM to MP3, to stream on Spotify, and now there is services being built on top of the blockchain, on top of Ethereum blockchain, which allow users to actually buy an album and just pay peer-to-peer directly the people that created that album. Mike Shinoda from Linkin Park, I'm sure everybody knows Linkin Park. Mike Shinoda built an NFT album. So the application are just an advantage for everybody at the end of the day. And I believe the decentralization is going to be applied at some point also to politics, to people that are actually, impacting the world. And I'm going to actually allow people to be able to vote for decisions that are going to impact their nation, their country. So, Federico, I think the advantage here, just applying a nutshell to your question, what's the advantage? The advantage is huge. A lot of people are just connecting blockchain to Bitcoin. And that's just the tip of the iceberg. Then, you go down a little bit, like we did, and then you go to Ethereum, and then you go to the DeFi, and then you say, okay, on DeFi, there is also video games, right? And then, your mind just explodes because there is so many information. It's a rabbit hole in the end. So just study, and, you will learn a lot of things.
Sure. Alex, you are... How to say, you are moving, you are present in many different virtual worlds and in many video games. So probably you know different community, big community in this different context in which you move daily. What is the feeling that you have? A big community can get used to NFT or are not used yet, because as it happened with crypto, many people, when you explain to them, if you buy a cryptocurrency, you become bank of yourself, so you have to take care of your coin, you should not lose the private key. They get panic because they are, yes, not used, they are not ready for a no centralized economy. They want the bank to keep their money safe. In the digital world or in video games, are people ready to buy something? Then if they lost the mobile, maybe they are not able to have this something back again.
So I think people are not ready for it yet. There's two kind of people. There's people that are willing to listen. In the end, all of my knowledge, I'm going to be very honest, all of my knowledge comes from YouTube. I didn't study books about blockchain. I just listened to podcasts and I learned. So I decided to invest the time to study. Many people are not willing to do that. Many people are more, willing to do other things, which is fine in the end of the day. So I think that the large community that I know, I know people that are probably between 16 to 24 years old that play video games, that play esports tournament that organize, and they're actually already exchanging skins, they're exchanging their characters. There's a video game called Brawl Stars from Supercell. Supercell is one of the biggest gaming company in the world. They come from Finland, they do billions each month, so billions of dollars. And their community is already exchanging in the gray market their characters. So once this company realized that there is already a market of people willing to actually do it in a legal way, this company are going to be the first one to jump on the blockchain train. And I already know some companies like Epic Games, we talked about them before, they're building their metaverse. So this company already know that it is a market. About the people, it's all a matter of technology. The moment that the blockchain and the wallet become more desktop, less desktop oriented and more mobile oriented, we will see really a switch. Because at the moment, what we have is many people that are using their wallet both on desktop and mobile, but desktop is definitely easier to use at the moment. So I guess the bigger winner of this world will be the people that really, the company that really try to make a user-friendly opportunity for people to use the wallet and to connect their wallet to their bank account. There is already some apps that which connect DeFi to bank account of people, but this is super early. So I guess video game will be one of the industries where people really will start to enter the crypto world. And if you go on TikTok and you see all of these youngsters that are, again, between 16 and 24 years old, they already talk about crypto. They already talk about investment. So at the end of the day, it's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when the world is going to switch slowly to crypto. And if you see PayPal, they're already allowing people to take away Bitcoin and Ethereum from the crypto of, wallet of PayPal and put in there in their own crypto wallets. We are very early, Federico. I think we are probably the we are still 2-3 years away from the biggest change that mankind has seen in finance. So I think this is happening soon.
It's clear. It's a new technology. People need to learn how to drive. No, it's like when the cars appear and people are not able to drive. You need that time, probably 10 or 20 years before people really was able have. Confident to drive a car, it will be the same with the cryptocurrency and crypto asset and Patini special. I cannot understand if there is some question. But I make another question for you, and then I try to understand if the advice, yes. I see in the screen a question or just the comments. One of the question I talked for you before start our panel is about the future of a virtual world. We know that few years ago there is many social community and then we was very clear that Facebook was the winning one, and everybody started to use Facebook. But yes. Maybe someone that is following the panel is so young and didn't experience the years at the end of the 90s, early 2000, a famous worldwide, a small world. But yes. Also in Italy, I remember we have many different community. We have fuoricorso.it that is a community of students at the beginning, very similar to Facebook, telling the truth. But then Facebook became the leader and everybody went to on Facebook. Same for chat, chatting app. In the early 2000, we have many different chat, and then half of the world is using WhatsApp. The other half, the Asian, is using WeChat. There is someone with Lime in Korea, but at the end, only two big platform remain. Allora, it's possible that in the future we are going to have only two virtual worlds. And starting now from so many, probably people understood that it's more beautiful, it's more useful to stay, to give time, to invest in NFT inside a virtual world and not in so many.
Yeah, it's a great question, Federico. I think it's not easy now to know, of course, which metaverse or which virtual world is going to win. We have several examples. We have the Decentraland, Axis Infinity, of course, the Sandbox. The Nemesis is starting now, but it's already as a great community. And then there is several others like Somnium. Any of these metaverse is trying to different things. For instance, Axis created a community where, you know, people are more about the fighting, the player versus player part, while Somnium Space is creating more of a virtual world, virtual reality experience, and using the Oculus Rift to actually build. The Sandbox at the moment is creating a connection between the avatar communities, all of these famous, the Ash Mask, the Bored Ape Yacht Club, and all of these NFT huge collections. So people will be able to use their NFT and actually to wear it in their metaverse. And then, of course, there is the play to earn concept, which is what we talked about before. So I think that we are entering in a world where the Web 3.0 will be different web, because now, of course, Facebook, Google, Amazon, I mean, the biggest corporation in the world, they controlled Web 2.0 for several reasons. My background actually comes from paid media and user acquisition. So it's something that I need to know. But to be honest with you, in the past couple of years, I'm becoming bored of this, you know, monopoly. Because in the end of the day, it's not good to have a monopoly in any kind of industry. Because at the end, Facebook, Instagram, and then Twitter, and then Amazon, they're going to decide what people need to see. There is an algorithm. In the decentralized world of the metaverses, the thing is switched from the other way around, because users are going to be the one that decides how they're going to build the metaverse. So if I buy a land in the Sandbox or in the Central and wherever I want, if I invest the money, I'm the only person allowed to decide what I'm going to put in that world. And it's good because it gives people the opportunity to be creative, to actually build an alternative world in any kind of meaning of as an alternative world. And I think that the Nemesis, for instance, has done a very great job to connect the real world to the virtual world, creating experiences where people need to solve a mission in the virtual world, and then they can get a coupon, for instance, to be used in the real world. And this is something that we're going to see in the future. So I don't think there's going to be a winner in the end. I think that people are going to keep building different communities. I think the big vertical is over. I think that now there's space for more, you know, people that are going to decide which topic are going to talk about for a social network as for the metaverse. So we will see many winners. What I expect to see by the end of this year, I expect many people to really understand this concept of metaverses and actually realize maybe I don't need an office job. Maybe I don't need a 9-to-5 job. Maybe I need to use these 2 hours in this day that I have to really make the best. Best for me, for my family, for my friends. I don't need to work 8 hours. Maybe I need to work just 2 hours, and in these 2 hours, I will be able to create a new job for myself. Maybe the metaverse, maybe in another industry. But the key again, Federico, to me is studying. So study, reading books, studying, listening to podcasts, to YouTube, listen to people that know about the topic, and you will learn way more than just watching Netflix. That's my big takeaway for today.
Bene, it's very interesting, and you just opened the contest for some of the questions that arrived, and now I can read on my screen. One is very interesting, and it's also the next question that I want to do you. What's happened to the generation of a Second Life? Second Life was really, really strong. I mean, I know people very young probably never know Second Life. In any case, they already saw like something old. But Second Life for a few years, how long? Maybe 10 years ago, was really,
yeah,
really,
I think it was,
really strong.
2003, more or less.
2003, but then till the end of 2010, 2011, they really, how to say, Second Life was really strong. If you think that the biggest, one of the biggest Italian crypto exchange that the name is The Rock Trading. It was born in 2007 as an exchange for Second Life money to euro. So much before Coinbase or the others, because so Second Life, what's happened? Why they disappeared?
I think the just that the world was not ready for that yet, because I think that, well, I was a little bit younger, so I don't remember very well, but I think that 2003, people were just realizing we are in the 2000, we are in a new era. So people were just, there were too many things happening at the same time. And video games was part of it, but video games were still seen as a nerd thing, as something just for nerds, for people that don't really care about going out. So, you know, you need the critical mass for something to be a success, right? So Second Life was a huge success. I also heard that there was some things happening in Japan where people were stealing objects in the virtual world, and then people in real life were finding these people and actually killed them because they stole a sword in the virtual world. So that's something crazy, like, if you think about it, right? But then I guess that at the time the connection was not that strong. The video gamer were seen as nerdy, and probably the graphic was not appealing yet. So something was missing. And, you know, sometimes some, for instance, MySpace, right? MySpace was before Facebook. It was perfect in the end, but what was missing was the critical mass. And then Facebook just took the concept a step forward, right? So from the Second Life experience, we saw many MMORPG, massive RPG online experiences. So people started playing. World of Warcraft was one experience where people were doing late nights. I was doing late nights myself when I was at high school with my classmates. And then, you know, day by day, we switched from a more video game concept to a movie concept. Metal Gear Solid switched from just being a video game to become a movie. So, and then movies started to do movies about video games. So, you know, there was a kind of a switch. And now, basically, we are creating a movie every day. We are doing a conference inside a metaverse. What's next is that I think the Second Life of that time is going to be one of these metaverses we talked about now. And I think that now we're ready. We're ready to not just play video games, but actually to have an experience, which is going to be one day, maybe we're not going to do Zoom calls. Maybe we're going to do a call inside the Nemesis, inside the Sandbox, inside Axis Infinity. We're going to call our colleagues in one of our lands, maybe the land of the company. So, you know, the opportunities are infinite, but I think that now Second Life generation is also in this generation of people that want to play again.
Allora, there is other two questions, but I will answer also the first one, but I prefer to jump in the order, so don't be worried. I will answer also the first one, but the second one is important because ERR97 from Milan asks, the fact that now we can enjoy the virtual worlds, also the video game from many different devices, especially mobile, give a completely different approach. In the past, even Second Life was based on the desktop computer. So somehow you cannot have a look just when you are on the metro line. No? So the fact that the virtual world are enjoyable from different devices, especially from mobile, can change completely the future of virtual worlds. I mean, can really become something very popular, especially in the question asked, can Nemesis have an advantage just because Nemesis can be used by different devices? Can be this the key to make it not famous for 1 year, 2 years, and then disappear?
Yes. So I think the future of not just video games, but any kind of application in Web 3.0 is be interconnectable between different devices, from desktop to mobile. People who just want to experience At the moment, I think that we, any kind of company should rethink their experience, because of course, being responsive to what the screen of the user looks like in that moment is key. I'm a huge fan of mobile gaming, but I think that the we are close to a moment where people are going to start buying more laptops again. So I think desktop is coming back, actually, not just from the desktop-oriented gamers, but for everybody at home. Now they're realizing, oh, maybe I don't need a television. Maybe I need just I just need a better laptop. So I think mobile gaming is going to be huge. Actually, mobile gaming just overtook the other games. PlayStation is still a thing, of course, but they are niche now compared to the huge mobile gaming industry. So just to give you a number, in the past 8 months, I organized esports tournament. We reached 333,000 people just from Italy on mobile game esports tournaments. And just multiply this number for huge countries like Brazil or India, and these numbers are huge worldwide. The female players are growing exponentially. Now female players are as close as the male players in mobile gaming. So we're talking to different audiences. I think that the key, as you mentioned before, the game changer for the Nemesis or for other metaverses can be really giving away the experience to all of the devices. Maybe I start to play when I'm in the metro, going back home from work, and then I keep playing when I go back home in a bigger screen. So I just want to keep the experience as flawless as possible on any kind of device. That's going to be the winner for me.
Clear. I understand your view, and I agree. Same with the new device, like web glass and so on. Probably we are approaching an era in which the access to virtual worlds and gaming, it will be so easy that probably much bigger audience will arrive. Girls, people from different age, adults, and very young as well. There is the first question somehow is in this direction as well, because it's about one of the reasons why the future of gaming can be more interesting for normal people. And it's about this. If in a game I have some kind of a price as a coin, as an NFT or a crypto coin that I can bring in my wallet, I can exchange, I can sell, so I can also transform in money. In the past, every time the price in game is a jump level or have some bonus, but it's not something that you can bring outside the game, outside the virtual worlds. Having a price, having some rewards in coin, give the opportunity to people also to cash in real money, in US dollar or euro. Can be this a killer application to make games and virtual worlds famous in the future?
So there is two sides of answer to this question. The first side is yes, definitely giving price is an advantage for companies trying to create buzz around their brand, around the metaverse, around, you know, any kind of industry, right? However, focusing just on the price that is in crypto or in fiat currency or, you know, where any kind of price is also a double-edged sword, because many people might just come to that company for the price. They might not come for the real value that is behind. Let's just think for 1 second to the 2017 ICO. Many companies were offering initial coin offering, and they were about to say, okay, we have this product. They were probably explaining in 2-3 pages in the white paper what they were talking about. And then just people jumped, throw money at them. And in the end, there was nothing, right? There was nothing. So this is not the case, of course, for many companies that are now growing in the metaverse. But there is still that feeling where many people just jump to buy, to get the price in the end, and then they will go away. So to me, Price are important, but it's more important to create like a sort of a community, something that goes beyond the price and giving people the opportunity to actually just believe in the project and start to build in the project themselves and becoming brand ambassadors. That's part of my job for the past 10 years, creating brand ambassadors rather than users. And I truly believe that if you find the right users, this will be the first one to do the dirty work, let's say, for free. Of course, then you need to give them prizes, that you need to give them something to show them that they created a value. Myself, actually, last year, when I bought land and estate in the Sandbox Metaverse, I just bought that by myself because I saw people so, you know, so attached to the project, so happy about giving their help, that I was like, okay, this is a community I want to be part of. This is a community I want to buy a piece of it. And then I started to, you know, to attract other people. And then in project, at some point you will see flags from Italy, from Spain, from Latin America that were, you know, putting the flags on their lands. So people were creating sub-communities. So to me, price is important, of course, because the connection between fiat currency and cryptocurrency is important to allow people that are not expert yet about crypto to enter, to put a foot in the door. But then people need to learn about what is crypto, and they need to learn about decentralization slowly, day by day. This is a key aspect, in my opinion.
And so you think that in the moment, for those that we really understand the value of crypto, how to say, no fungible token or fungible token as crypto, they don't really care to cash in euro dollars because they are happy to live in a crypto space. So I for think, you, yeah, it's not I really think... the key point, the fact that you can cash the price, you can cash the rewards in a euro or whatever.
I think that people, of course, it depends from the audience. There is people that are more risk-oriented because at the end of the day, crypto is still a risk and it will be a risk forever, as the US dollar and euro investment are. If you invest in euro or in US dollar today, you need to understand that there is no limit to the amount of dollars that can be created. This year, we saw the highest amount of US dollar created in history. So it's always a risk when you invest in something. So if you're prepared for the risk, I think that people probably need to 1 second to zoom out and say, okay, today is the 3rd of June 2021. Zoom out in 2024, 2028, how will people pay? If you think about just 2, 3, 4 years ago, yes, people had WhatsApp, but how many people were asking to do a birthday gift together and give a PayPal link to actually receive money? This is something that is happening a lot to me lately with some friends of mine. And now people are entering the mindset where this digitalization of money is just becoming a huge thing. So when you keep this told and you bring it to 2024, how many people will be investing in crypto? How many of your friends have told to you about Bitcoin or even Dogecoin? Dogecoin is a problem, in my opinion, but that's not a story. That's not for today. But it's still opening people's eyes to the opportunity of what is crypto. When Elon Musk has, I don't know, now we might have 60,000 million followers, he talks about something, he opens people's eyes. Mark Cuban, which is the owner of an NBA team in the United States, and that's already says a lot, and has millions of followers as well. When he talks about NFT, he talks about Polygon, which is an Ethereum layer 2 protocol, he say that he invested in a layer 2 protocol of Ethereum to 8 million followers. So this is huge. Like, we don't understand how this is, you know, becoming a huge thing. So my thing is always what I've been saying for the whole call. Do your own research, study, but consider open yourself to keeping your investment in crypto, because this is something that might turn as a double turn, 4x, 5x in the long run, or might turn to zero. That's your choice, but that's also something that could happen.
Okay, allora, our time is over because it was 45 minutes, but we have three questions. So I hope the organizer let us 5 minutes more so we can answer these three new questions. and then close our chat. One is very interesting because you said are all interesting, but this one I think is in the line of our speech. NFIT and any case also standard coin, so fungible coin or no fungible coin, can allow people to bring this asset in your wallet. So probably in the future we can go to a cross platform case in which maybe I won a prize in a games, but I bring this in another games. Can give this cross platform asset transfer some legal problems, because we know that especially many countries, Italy as well. I speak by Italy because I know better than another country, but I know it's very similar. Price have roots from the strawberry points at the supermarket to the flying miles of the airlines. They have very strict rules. So until you stay inside the contest of this rewarding program with these rules is okay, but if you want to jump in another program, is illegally somehow. What can happen with NFT and crypto rewards in different games or in different digital worlds?
Yeah, I think this is an issue that touches many points that are legal oriented points. So I'm not a legal person, but what I can tell you is that I understand what you say in terms of like the issue. I think that one of the industries that will grow a lot in terms of like blockchain will be the legal industry. It's funny because I was just talking about this with a lawyer friend yesterday, and she was actually considering to study more and to switch to the blockchain industry because there is many opportunities, but also there are a lot of questions that are still unanswered because crypto is still not regulated in many ways. There is still many black holes that need to be filled with legal. So in terms of pricing, there is many collaboration. Just for instance, the Sandbox made a collaboration with Zepeto, which is a Korean metaverse. So there was a collaboration where these two metaverses created, gave a land to each other, and they created assets for each other. So these things are already happening. And how, what the big question is, how, which kind of legal, which kind of law is going to be applied when there is a metaverse which is based in Hong Kong or in North Korea? You know, there is a new country which is the internet. So there is some things that in a real world might be solved, but in the virtual world, there is just no jurisdiction, so to speak. And this happens way more when there is decentralization. So we talked a lot, we say a lot of good things about decentralization, but there's also a lot of threats. There's a lot of things that are dangerous. So it's very important to understand what, first of all, when we connect a wallet to a website, be careful because you need to trust that website. Many things can happen when you connect the wallet. So it's really more a matter of like how much you put effort into research that you're doing at the moment rather than thinking to law, in my opinion. But if there is some lawyers listening that are considering switching or studying blockchain, I think there is a huge opportunity because many companies, just think about the classic corporations that have no idea about blockchain and they want to jump on the train, they will need some consultants. So in the next years, of course, or now to next year. So jump into that would be something that actually, I will be the first to actually willing to listen to somebody talking about this topic on a podcast or in real life.
And this is clear. In fact, you said until we remain in crypto space, probably the jump between different programs or different platforms could be no deal. But one question ask a step more. I mean, probably I have no problem when I jump from different games, but in the moment in which I cash the rewards that I got. So I want to transform this reward in cash. I have maybe many countries don't allow me to do it, or I have different rules for tax and so on. Do you think, this is just your idea, your opinion, do you think that in the future we are going to have a kind of general rules, or country will remain a so strong barrier for crypto?
Yeah, I think nobody can stop crypto, in the sense that if you want to stop crypto, you need to close the internet in some way. So there's actually other ways, like you can become the owner of the blockchain. 51% of the blockchain needs to be yours, which in the case of Bitcoin, for instance, is impossible today. Maybe in the future will be possible, but today is impossible. It's not very easy to stop a blockchain. So if countries want to actually embrace crypto, that's good for them, because embracing crypto will give them opportunities. If you think about Cardano, what Cardano has been doing in Africa, just creating partnership with Ethiopia lately, and maybe some people in the call think that Cardano is just a scam, it's just another team which is going to be killed, which is possible. But Cardano actually is one of the blockchain at the moment which is creating already creating potential million of real case users, because Ethiopia has millions of users. They're creating partnerships with Zimbabwe. Their plan is actually to expand to Africa. So there is countries which are actually embracing crypto. Iran has a lot of problem with the United States. Now, I don't want to give judgment about the politics, because that's not the place to do that. But a country like Iran, which has a lot of problem coming from outside of their of the country, they can actually build mining stations, and they can create revenues in crypto. I don't know, just thinking about Venezuela, people in the street are using banknotes to sew bags. Like, they're using the banknotes to sew bags, because banknotes from Venezuela have no value whatsoever. So these countries actually need to exit the fiat currency, the debt that other countries, other more powerful countries have created, or other dictators have created in their country. And they need to start from scratch, start over, because otherwise they will not be able to grow again. Because now, in this world of capitalism, the problem is that there is this hyper-growth need. While sometimes you don't need just hyper-growth, you need to actually go slower. So crypto, it might sound like a big, huge thing, but crypto is an opportunity for the world to start over, to exit the banks in some ways, or to at least to create a job for yourself. In the sandbox, I met one person last year which had no idea about crypto, had no idea about how to create an NFT. And in 1 year, now he's a full-time member of the sandbox as an artist. And he created this job during the quarantine, during the COVID. And this is a real case history for everybody to say, just studying something is going to open you new doors. So that's all you need to do.
The last question, we go back to the topics, the topic we discussed before, that is Second Life. One of from our audience said Second Life had no reason to exist in reality, because it's not a game, it's not a real virtual world. Do you think that it will go to close completely its server in the future or not?
I'm not sure about what's their plan, but I think that in this era, if they're still active, it would be a shame to not try to enter in the blockchain as well, because this will give new life to Second Life. The sandbox itself was actually a mobile game which turned to blockchain, so it's already a case history of something that was created for a different purpose and then turned into the blockchain. I think that many other applications now will turn to blockchain as well. They will insert new blockchain feeling or even real blockchain inside the application. So I think the Second Life maybe might turn one day. It really depends what is the user base. I'm not quite sure actually how many users are still using Second Life.
Okay, Alex, was very interesting chat with you. I hope that our audience could understand our Italian English, and your English probably is more, how to say, without accent, so strong as mine. So I hope everybody could follow us in this almost 1 hour we was together. Thank you again for your time, and all the best for this NFT Expo, and a big hug to all of you.
Thank you, Federico. Thank you very much for everybody that watched us. Bye.
Okay. Bye.